So in this session, we shall be looking at the taxation of individuals. So we are bringing together the various sources of income that an individual may have. Now, here's the key thing. We have to segregate the incomes. So it means that we deal with employment income separately, rental income separately, if you have dividend and interest separately. Don't mix them up. With regards to how we go about the computation, it's very simple. Whenever you are given a scenario about a certain person, let's call him Mapengo, and you're given information about his employment, you first deal with his employment income. So with regards to the employment income, you'll have to consider things like basic pay. You'll have to consider things like his allowances, things like his car benefits, etc. Remember that with regards to employment income, the last benefit that we always consider is the housing benefit. So after you've done this, this is just a simplification, we now look at the housing benefit. And then we add it here. Remember that with regards to benefits, when you're looking at your taxable income, always take the higher. So if, for example, we are dealing with housing benefit, so we'll be dealing with the actuals or 15% of taxable pay, which is basically this. So whichever is higher is what you would take. Once you get this, then we are allowed to make deductions. And the key deductions that we shall be allowed to have is contributions by self to Providence schemes that are registered. And in this scenario, whenever you are looking at deductions, we shall be looking at whatever is lower. The examiner or the taxman always gives you what is lower whenever you are deducting, because he wants to maximize your taxable income. Okay, so things like contribution to registered provident funds, where we look at either actual that is given out, or we look at 20k per month. These are the set rates, which comes to 40k in a year, or 30% of pensionable pay, where pensionable pay is this amount here, inclusive of housing benefit. So whichever is less is what they take. So they'll allow you to make that deduction. If you have made contributions, let's say, to a home ownership savings scheme, they'll also allow you to do that. Home ownership savings plan. So you've been making some deposits with HFCK and such registered bodies, they'll allow you. But again, they'll take the lower of the actual contributions or the maximum, which is allowed, which is 48K per year. So whichever is lower is what they'll allow. So you do that, then you get what is the taxable employment income. So once you get your taxable employment income, you are now in a position to look at other incomes. Now here's the trick. Whenever you're looking at other incomes, you have to omit any incomes that are not subjected to further tax. Here we are talking about things like qualifying dividends and qualifying interest, whereby the withholding tax is normally the final tax and you're not supposed to tax them any further. So you will not include them here. Or even if you include them, you'll include them and then put the amount as nil. So the qualifying dividend or interest, you say nil. You're not supposed to tax it again. However, if you're dealing with other aspects, let's say you have some rental income, then the net rental income is going to be added here. Remember what we said when we looked at rental income? You're allowed to, from the gross rent, to deduct any reasonable expenses that are used to generate that rent. And the same applies to farming income. Okay? Now, a small note about farming income. There's a small issue of what we call presumptive tax. And it has been coming in and going out of the various finance acts each year whenever the budget is read. So with regards to the presumptive income tax, if you find that there's a presumptive tax in the question with regards to farming income, then know that the presumptive tax is final tax, meaning that if there's presumptive tax, then here you shall say nil. But if there's no presumptive tax, then you'll just add up the farming income, or these are now the profits, yeah, to whatever you have here. So you add all of these sources, gives you a taxable income. Okay. Now that you have gotten your taxable income, the next thing is to use the prescribed rates. Now, in Kenya, we have rates of 10, 15, 20, 25, and 30. It's a progressive tax. So what would happen is that if I'm using like the rates that I'm using now, for the first 121,968 is taxed at that. Then the next 114,912 will be taxed at 15. And then in batches of 114,912 at 20. The next 114,912,912 at 25, and then any extra amount is going to be applied this rate of 30%. That's how we do it. Now, these percentages here don't change. However, these brackets change. As we speak now, the Finance Act that was passed in 2017 has changed these brackets. However, now it will be used in 2018, when you'll be filing the 2017 returns. For purposes of our exams in 2017, we are not yet clear as to which rates the examiner will use. The good thing is that these rates of tax are always provided in the exam question. So if in the December sitting, December 2017, they opt to still retain these rates of tax, well and good. If they retain them until the June 2018 sitting, well and good. But if they change and they apply the changes very fast and they start using the new rates, then use whatever rates you'll find in your question paper. Okay? So the concept will be the same, even if these numbers will differ slightly. Okay? Now, once you get your tax, whatever your tax is, this is your gross tax, you are allowed to make some deductions. And the deductions that you are allowed to make, the first one is the personal relief. So the personal relief is currently at 13,944. Remember, the relief may change, the amounts. A certain government may decide they want to give a certain stimulus, they want to increase the relief, no problem. But the tax computation remains the same. Only that the figures here would be different. The logic remains the same. So the key thing is to remember that even if you're watching this video and these rates have changed, use whatever rates that the examiner will have given you in the exam paper. And then we also less insurance relief. Now, insurance relief is usually based on either 15% of the premiums or the set limits. which is 5k per month, whichever is less, you are allowed to make that. Okay, so that you get what your net tax is. Now, in case you are told in the question that there was already payee deducted a source, you'd also have deducted it. Okay, or if you're dealing with an income whereby the withholding tax is not the final tax, let's say you're dealing with dividends from a cooperative society or in interest from a cooperative society, which are not among the prescribed financial institutions, meaning that the withholding tax that they'll have charged you is not final tax, then here's where you'll say less the withholding tax already deducted. Okay, but that is a key thing. So again, just to give you an overview, so we first start with employment income. After you get your employment income, you now add other incomes. That you get your total income. Once you get this total income, apply the rates of tax. This will give you your tax. And from this tax, you less personal relief. You less insurance relief. And you less tax credits, so tax that has already been paid, whether you're talking about PAYE or you're talking about withholding tax, whatever it is, this will give you your net tax liability. Remember that if you make losses in any of these other categories, you cannot offset them against employment income. So if you have a business loss, for example, then that loss can be carried forward to the next period. But that does not mean that you shall get a refund for what you paid as payee on your employment income. Okay, so a concept that really confuses many students is the difference between allowable deductions versus reliefs. Notice that reliefs are deducted from tax, from gross tax. That's when you deduct the reliefs, personal relief and insurance relief. While deductions are deducted from incomes. So when you're talking about contributions to home ownership savings plan or to a provident fund, NSSF, blah, blah, these ones you deduct them from incomes. Reliefs is after you've already applied the rates of tax, you already have your gross tax, that's when you come and deduct them here. Okay? And that basically gives you a summary of the taxation of individuals.